Good morning, everyone. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to be together in this house. We thank you, Father, for the change in seasons. Thank you that you are a God that is always full of surprises, unexpected things, and just we love you and appreciate you today. And I pray for your presence to come into this house today. I ask, Father, for your strength as I share, Lord, your words. I pray your anointing to be upon me. I pray, Father, if I don't quite get it right, that you would take these words and let them land exactly where you want them to land today. It's your words. It's your words from your scriptures. Father, we lift up all of those in our congregation who are sick, battling all kind of things, and we just pray that you would bring healing, healing to your people today. We give you praise and we give you glory that you love us, you care for us, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, I do want to remind you that today is our final lesson for this session. We will break for the holidays, and then we will come back on February the 7th. So that will be the first Tuesday in February, and we will be continuing 2 Timothy. So you might want to keep that on your calendar. It felt kind of funny to type that out to Sharon last night, February 7th, 2023. But it's coming. It'll be faster than we know. All righty. Well, let's get into our study today. We have moved into chapter 2 of 2 Timothy. And in each one of these passages, the Apostle Paul is still trying to motivate his sweet friend Timothy, who pastors the church at Ephesus. And so far in this chapter, Paul has given Timothy some direct commands, starting with, be strong in the grace of Jesus Christ. And this grace of Jesus Christ is why Timothy can be strong, because his grace is sufficient for our every need. Amen? This grace is a privilege, and while Timothy's living in this grace of Jesus Christ, he now has the responsibility of obedience, so Paul gives him some other commands. He's instructed to teach everything he's been taught. He was exhorted to be a good soldier and to endure hardship. He was told to be a good athlete and compete within the rules, and to be a hardworking farmer taking part of the crops himself. And each one of these would help Timothy motivate him to remain strong in the grace of Jesus Christ. Well, today we're looking at an approach that Paul takes with Timothy that to me seems a little bit more forceful than what we've seen before. And that is simply, God is faithful. And it's not so much that God is faithful to us in his relationship with us, that is true, but that God remains faithful to being himself. He doesn't change. He remains the same, regardless of what we believe about him or even how we respond to him. He's still God, and he's going to be God, regardless of us. So let's start at verse 8. Of 2 Timothy chapter 2, and read down to verse 13. Remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead according to my gospel, for which I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even to the point of chains, but the word of God is not chained. Therefore I endure all things for the sake of the elect, that they also may obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. This is a faithful saying. If we died with him, we shall also live with him. If we endure, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful. He cannot deny himself. Okay, so let's unpack this. Paul goes right into reminding Timothy of Jesus Christ and his resurrection. And I think this is just a bit jolting because this is a truth that's almost given. You know, how could Timothy forget this? But Paul is getting to the very root of Timothy's spiritual life. It's almost as if he is having Timothy go back to where it all began. And it's because of Jesus Christ dying on a cross for our sins, resurrecting, that we even have this sphere of grace that Timothy, that Paul, all of us are living in. It's because of Jesus Christ that Timothy has a gift that Paul is trying to stir up in him. It's because of Jesus Christ that Paul was preaching that he was in prison now for. So everything is centered around Jesus Christ. And it seems simple enough, a simple truth, but Paul feels the urgency here to remind Timothy, remember that Jesus Christ, the seed of David, rose from the dead. And Paul pulls in here this term, seed of David, almost as if to kind of, again, jolt Timothy, to remind him of the Old Testament scriptures. And David was from the Old Testament, and that was a phrase that was used to describe Jesus from the Old Testament. He was the prophesied Messiah back in the Old Testament. So these were writings that Timothy would have been familiar with. And this was a reminder to Timothy of everything that he had learned from the Old Testament scriptures, which pointed that it would be this Jesus Christ who rose from the dead. Now, this is a simple truth for Paul to write, nothing elaborate, very basic. Remember, Timothy, that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. But it's a powerful statement, because this simple truth sets apart Christianity from every other religion in the world. No other religious leader, no other God, no one else ever has done what Jesus did. Rose from the dead on his own power. Only Jesus Christ. Paul had written to the Christians in Corinth, 2 Corinthians 15:14, and if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty and your faith is also empty. Verse 17, he says, if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Everything about our life in Christ centers on the fact that Jesus Christ rose from the dead triumphant over sin. This truth of Christ's resurrection is the foundation of our faith, and it's what divides us and separates us from other religions. Without his resurrection, our faith is futile. And Paul wants Timothy to remember this powerful truth, because in remembering the resurrection, Timothy is going to remember that Jesus Christ is the living Lord. The living Lord. He's alive. He's not dead. He's alive. He's seated at the right hand of God. This is who Jesus Christ is. This is what he's done for us, all of us, humanity, the whole world. Remember Jesus Christ who rose from the dead. And Paul makes it clear here that this is the gospel that he has preached. You know, just in case there were false teachers who were filling Timothy's head with arguments against Paul and his ministry, Paul's reminding Timothy, this is the gospel that I have preached. I preached it to you, and I've preached it to countless others. You have heard me preach this gospel, Jesus Christ's resurrection. And it's this very preaching of Jesus Christ's resurrection that has put Paul in a Roman prison cell. He writes here in verse 9 that he's being treated as if he were a criminal. He's chained, you know, as if society needed to be protected from him. What had he done? All he had done was preach the risen Jesus Christ. And certainly this shows up, the mixed up mind of the world. Something that's so beautiful, that brings hope, joy, peace, brings the light into the darkness. Those following the mind of Satan would want to shut this message down. Ephesians 2:2 tells us that there is a spirit who works in the sons of disobedience. It's coming from the prince of the power of the air. Satan has been given power in this earth. It's limited, but he still has power, and his influence over the minds and the hearts of people cause them to go against, it works in them to go against anything pertaining to the kingdom of God. And Satan's power is still at work today. Paul wrote in chapter 4 of 2 Timothy, his power would continue to work, turning the ears of people away from the truth and turning them toward lies. And this is why we pray. We pray, Holy Spirit, open up those blinded spiritual eyes. Open up those ears that are deaf to the truth and bring a revelation of that light into the darkness. We have to pray. We have to pray. And we pray in faith. Because it's not hopeless. It's not hopeless. God is still working. He is still working. And at the end of verse 9, Paul interjects in this gloomy picture of him being in chains, treated like a criminal, these powerful words, "But the word of God is not chained." The word of God is not chained. Ooh, what a powerful truth to get into our spirit today. You know, for starters, the word of God was powerful enough to get out of that dungeon where Paul was writing this. I don't know how the Lord did that. I don't know where he even got the pen and ink to write this. I don't know how he got it all out of the dungeon. Was there a soldier helping him? We don't know that part of the story, but what we do know that is just as Paul was writing these words, God was working to get his word out to those who needed to hear it. His word is not chained. Rome may have wanted to snuff Paul out. He spoke words of conviction. He threatened their antichrist agenda, but Rome could never snuff out the truth that Paul was preaching and the truth that he was writing. Christ's truth will always prevail. It cannot be canceled. The truth of Jesus Christ dying on the cross, loving us, his resurrection, his power to help us live over sin, these words will prevail. They are not chained. So let me just remind you of a few promises about the word of God. 1 Peter chapter 1. Peter is writing about this beautiful salvation, and he says that here in verse 23, we've been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible, through the word of God, which lives and abides forever. Because, and he goes on here, all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of the grass. The grass withers, and its flower falls away, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Amen. The Antichrist spirit may try to burn all the Bibles, keep the Bible out of public places, but all those things, all their efforts, it's not going to destroy the truth of the word of God that endures forever. These words will continue on. The truth is going to remain. It's still in the clouds. You can't delete them. The word of the Lord endures forever. They are not chained to any circumstance. These words are not just another book. They are the words of the Almighty God. Hebrews 4:12. The word of God is living. No other book in the world is living. It's living and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit and joints and marrow. And it's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. And this is why Rome wanted to shut Paul down. He was preaching words that convicted them. But even if you shut down the messenger, the message will continue. And verse 13 of Hebrews 4 says, "There is no creature hidden from God's sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give account." And that's why you see so much anger and gnashing of teeth. The truth of God's word cannot be escaped. You cannot get away from what he has already spoken and settled in the heavens. I just read this yesterday, Psalms 147, 15. He sends out his command to the earth, and his word runs swiftly. It's going so fast. Just when the enemy thinks he's captured all the words of the Lord, there's more coming. It runs swiftly. And what's encouraging about all of this is that as we share God's word with others, Whether they receive it at that moment or not, his words will continue to influence, will continue to pierce the heart and speak deep to that spirit. His words are going to continue long after we've walked away, or in Paul's case, after he was martyred. The word of God doesn't stop speaking just because the sermon's over or just because the conversation's over. His word is powerful. God has a purpose and a plan for every word of truth that's ever been given out or shared with someone. Let me read this from Isaiah 55, starting in verse 10. For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. The rain, the snow, they have a purpose. So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper or break through in the thing for which I sent it. The word of God is intentional. Just as the rain and the snow have a purpose of bringing fruit to the earth, the word of God has a purpose, has a plan. It's intentional. God's not playing around with his word. It's not flippant. It's going to prevail with purpose, no matter what Satan tries to do to fight against it. How comforting is that? The word that brings us life, it brings us hope, it guides us, directs us, comforts us. It can't be taken away from our spirits, even if someone tried to take the actual written pages from us. And as you read your winter read, Evidence Not Seen, you're going to see that in this book. Some of you probably already have if you started it. His word is alive. It's his words to us, straight from his heart to our heart. Oh, if we could keep that in our mind every time we sit down to read it. God is speaking to you directly through these written words, and it's still powerful to change us. Paul writes that over in 2 Timothy 3:16. All scriptures given by inspiration. We know this verse well. It's profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. It still has the power to change us. His word is powerful and it cannot be chained. Oh, no matter what was happening in Paul and Timothy's world, the truth of Jesus and the words of God could not be chained. And this truth was bigger than even Paul, who was stuck in a dungeon. It was bigger than Timothy, who was struggling with his faith, believing it all. And I'm reminding you this morning, the truth of Jesus Christ, it's bigger than each one of us. It's bigger than anything we're facing. His word will prevail. And so with this message alive and on fire in Paul's heart, Paul could write in verse 10, Therefore, I endure all things. Paul was going through a lot. He had already gone through a lot. That passage in 2 Corinthians 11, where he lists all the things that happened to him as a minister, is just incredible. But he endured all these things. He kept going in spite of all those things because he knew what he was preaching was absolute truth, and the message had to get out there. He had to go and tell it. So he endured all these things, he says here, for the sake of the elect. Now, this word elect here is a description of those who have not yet received the salvation of Jesus Christ. It's not a verse about predestination where only a few are going to be saved. God's picked them and we can't witness to anyone because God already picked them out. That's not what Paul is saying here, okay? It's talking about those who have yet to believe on Christ. Now, certainly once they've believed and received this message of Christ, they are the elect. Amen? We are the elect. We have believed. We have received. We are chosen in God. So Paul is enduring all of these things so that others may obtain the salvation in Jesus Christ with eternal glory. And if you think about all that Paul went through to preach the gospel, you just have to know it without a doubt. This man loved Jesus and he loved souls. You know, if you look at the book of Acts, where you see a lot of the stories about Paul, he never let an opportunity miss of sharing Jesus. Even when a crowd was gathering to beat him up or arrest him or, you know, get away, do away with him, he was like, ah, it's people, it's souls. They may hate me, but it's souls, and I'm going to preach Jesus. He loved Jesus, and he loved souls. He wasn't living for himself, and he wasn't even living for his own ministry. His heart and his passion was for others to be saved, no matter the cost to himself. Oh, that the Holy Spirit would give us that mentality. Help us to live so selflessly. Paul wanted everyone to hear about Jesus. The Jesus who had changed his life, had changed his life's direction. He wanted them to experience Jesus just like he had. And this is truly the heart of a missionary, of an evangelist, really of any of us following Christ. We love Jesus and we love souls. Paul loved souls and he wanted them to have the same salvation that he had experienced in Jesus. And you know, as Timothy is reading this, he has to be reminded, when he sees that phrase, I have endured all things. He has to be reminded of all the painful things that Paul had endured. Maybe he was with Paul on some of these, or he certainly would have known them up close and personal because he had spent so much time with Paul. And as Timothy is reading this letter, he has to think, you know, if this man writing this letter endured all these things so someone else could be saved, someone else could grow in Christ, surely, surely I can endure for the sake of the gospel. Surely there is something truthful in this message that he is preaching. There had to be something stirring up in Timothy. There has to be something of truth and value and significance to the gospel that Paul is preaching, that Timothy had received. If there was a waffling or a fading or you know, like a discouragement with Timothy, surely as he read this verse, he had to be stirred in his heart as he thought about what Paul had endured for the sake of others. There was something powerful in Paul's message. There was something of great eternal significance. It was truth. And it wasn't just going to affect Timothy, but it was going to affect all the people he's ministering to. And so you can't help but read some of this and just kind of want to reach in the pages and shake Timothy. Say, wake up. And then all of a sudden you stop and you realize, you know what? This is to convict me. This is to stir me, to motivate me. Paul had endured so many things for the sake of others. He goes on in verse 11, and he says, this is a faithful saying. And then he begins to write what many scholars feel was a commonly known quote or a creed that was spoken when the early church would get together for their services. Some even think that it was actually a hymn and had been set to music, and they might have sung it. So no doubt it would have been familiar to Timothy. Timothy would have known this saying. And I think, again, that is so creative of Paul. He is just pulling in anything that he can as the Holy Spirit gives him wisdom and inspires him. So let's look at the lines of this faithful saying. The second half there of verse 11. For if we died with him, we shall also live with him. Now, this kind of sounds like a bit of an oxymoron, doesn't it? And there's two truths hidden in that phrase. When we receive Christ as Savior, our old man, that Adamic nature, dies. We are reborn. There is a spiritual rebirth. We looked at Jesus' conversation with Nicodemus in John 3 last week. You must be born again. And there's more description here. I want to read this from Romans 8, starting in Romans 6, starting in verse 5. For if we have been united together in the likeness of his death, his crucifixion, certainly we also shall be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin, that Adamic nature, might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin. For he who has died has been freed from sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death that he died to sin once for all. But the life that he lives to God. Likewise, you also reckon yourselves to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Isn't that a beautiful passage? I know it's heavy with doctrine, but good stuff. In salvation, there is death, a crucifixion to our old man. Just as Christ was crucified, we're crucified in him. But we don't stay dead. Jesus didn't stay dead. He was resurrected, and now we are risen in new life with him. There's a death, but there's a new life. So that's one truth from this faithful saying here. We can also look at it as this. If we are believers in Christ, once our physical body has died and our time on earth has ended, then we're promised a new body in heaven. Paul wrote about this in chapter 4, Second Timothy, verse 6. For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing. Paul knew that his time on earth was coming to an end. Oh, but there was a new life in heaven he was anticipating. And this suffering that he was going through here on earth, it wasn't all there was to it. There was another life yet to be lived, living in heaven where there would be no tears, no pain, no sorrow. That verse in Revelation 21, so beautiful. God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, no sorrow, no crying, no more pain, for the former things have passed away. How beautiful is that? There's no pain or suffering here on earth that heaven cannot heal. Oh, what a promise. What a promise. So the faithful saying goes on. Verse 12, if we endure, we shall also reign with him. If we endure the suffering, the trials, the persecutions for the cause of Christ, we shall reign with him. We shall experience an eternal kingdom where Christ's glory is reigning and ruling, and we get to be a part of that. If we endure suffering, we will reign with him. We will experience and participate in his glory and in the eternal kingdom. Paul writes over in Romans 8, he says that we are heirs of God. We're children now. We're heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ. If indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time, and this is Paul writing this, are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. And if you keep on reading this, you'll look down in verse 25. But if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with perseverance. And I'm sure there were some days Paul was more eagerly waiting for that than others. If we endure, we shall also reign with him. Look at what 1 Peter 3 says. 1 Peter 4, sorry. Verse 12. Beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing has happened to you. But rejoice to the extent that you partake of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. No matter the suffering, even a fiery trial, there is glory to be anticipated. And if you go on to read the rest of that chapter, 1 Peter 4, Peter exhorts us that Christ's glory will rest upon us in that fiery trial, in that suffering, even before we get to heaven. And I want to share with you this morning, I know it's a passage we've looked at probably before, but over in Acts 7, where we see the death of Stephen. He's a godly man. He's a deacon filled with the Holy Spirit, doing a great work there with the new church. Well, they didn't like what he was saying, and so he's brought to the Sanhedrin Council, and he's continuing to preach the truth of Jesus Christ, the resurrected Messiah. And all the members of the council are convicted at Stephen's words. In chapter 7, verse 54, it says, when they heard these things, they were cut to the heart. Didn't we read about the Bible being a two-edged sword? They were cut to the heart, and they gnashed at him with their teeth. But he, being full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Now, this is the only time in the New Testament where Jesus is described as standing by the right hand of God. In other places, it talks about him sitting. But here, at Stephen's death, he is standing. And you almost have to wonder, for every martyr that's gone to be with the Lord, did Jesus stand up and welcome them home? I don't know, but he was standing here with Stephen. And Stephen is experiencing the glory of God at this moment, and something happens to Stephen's face. If you look back in chapter 6, verse 15, and all who sat in the council looking steadfastly at him saw his face as the face of an angel. You know, you would have thought that that would have been enough to give testimony that maybe what he was saying was true and you ought to listen. But that's not what happened. Verse 57. They cried out with a loud voice and stopped their ears. Tried to shut out the message, didn't they? And they ran at him with one accord, and they cast him out of the city and stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their clothes at the feet of a young man named Saul, who we know became Paul. And they stoned Stephen as he was calling on God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he knelt down and cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not charge them with this sin. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. Stephen had suffered for the cause of Christ, and now he was reigning with Christ. He was experiencing all of the glory of Jesus. And right here in the middle of his death, being stoned by these religious leaders who should have known better, Stephen is experiencing the glory of God from a kingdom that is way beyond this world. Now, whether he felt the pain of the stones, I don't know. But what I do know is that what Stephen saw with his eyes confirmed to him that everything he had been teaching about Jesus was true. And there was no way he was going to go backward and recant any of that sermon he had just preached. Whether it cost him his life or not, he believed everything he had just said. He was not taking it back. What he saw was greater. What he was experiencing at that moment was more powerful than any of the pain he might have felt from those stones. He saw Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Was Jesus smiling? I think so. I think he might have already been saying, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." I don't know. But he saw Jesus standing there in all of this heavenly glory, and that was absolutely enough for Stephen. No going back. If we endure, we shall also reign with him. Now, the end of verse 12, 2 Timothy, still with the faithful saying, "If we deny him, he also will deny us." And this is not just denying that we ever knew Christ like Peter did at Jesus' trial. And we know Peter repented of that. He received forgiveness. But this is also talking about denying or contradicting who Jesus is, who he is in all of his power. It's rejecting his truth, his deity as the Son of God. It's denying or contradicting that he rose from the dead, contradicting that his crucifixion is enough for our salvation, or that the words he spoke, it's not truth. It's not just enough to say, "I believe in Jesus as Messiah," but we must believe he is all he truly is. Believe every part of him, every word that he said about himself, his character, his holiness, his deity, everything. We want to believe, we must believe everything about him. Later in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 5, Paul writes about those who have a form of godliness but deny its power. And this is the same word here. False prophets projected an image of godliness following Christ. They said the right things, but yet in reality, there was a denying, a rejection of the very truths of Jesus that would have given them power. But they would rather have the false image, was probably more socially accepted. They didn't want the power, because to receive the power of Christ, you have to receive all of Christ. And that means a complete surrender to all that he is. If we deny him, he will also deny us. Jesus said these words in Matthew 10, 32. "Therefore, whoever confesses me before men, him I will also confess before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, him I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven." Very sobering words and very convicting to all of us. Then the last line of this faithful saying: "If we are faithless, he remains faithful. He cannot deny himself." What a beautiful promise on those days that we just don't quite hit the mark like we want to. Jesus is still faithful. He loves us, he encourages us, forgives us, gives us strength to get back up and get going. 1 John 3:20 says, "If our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart, and he knows all things. He sees us where we are. He hears our prayer of repentance. He forgives us. His mercies are new every morning." He's faithful to us. It's a beautiful truth. But this passage here is also talking about God's faithfulness, in that even if we don't have the faith to believe him, he is still faithful. He remains true to himself. He is still the God who saves, whether there's faith to believe for salvation or not. He's still the God who can perform a miracle, whether we believe him or not. He still has that power. That hasn't changed. His character hasn't changed simply because we don't have faith. He cannot deny himself. He's still the God who saves, whether unbelievers receive him or not. He's still the God who has the power to heal, whether we ever ask him for healing or not. Are you following that? Does that make sense? Romans 3:3 says, "For what if some did not believe? Will their unbelief make the faithfulness of God without effect? No. God is still the God who forgives. He's still God. He remains the same. He doesn't change. James 1:17 tells us, there's no variation or shadow of turning with God. James had been talking about God as the creator of sun, moon, and stars, the father of lights. And even those natural lights, they change with seasons, they change with the time of day. Our God does not change. There's no variation or shadow of turning with him. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever, Hebrews 13:8. He cannot, will not, is not able, he cannot deny himself. He has to remain faithful to who he is as a loving God, willing to forgive all those who come to him. He has to remain faithful. He's going to be with us to the end of the age. He stays the same. He's not going to deny himself. And so if we look at this entire passage, Paul is presenting all of this to remind Timothy. You may be struggling with your faith, but God is still faithful. You may have forgotten Jesus Christ rose from the dead. You may have forgotten the significance of that, the importance of that in your life. But he still remains Jesus Christ who rose from the dead. The power of that hasn't changed. You may have forgotten the word of God, Timothy, that your grandma taught you, your mom. Oh, but that word is still powerful and it's still going forward. It's still doing its work. It's still going according to the purposes and the plans that God intended. Just because we deny a truth about Christ, or we don't believe it, or we can't grasp it, whether it's his deity, his holiness, compassion, salvation, whatever it is, it suddenly doesn't make it null and void. His truth is still truth. He's Jesus Christ. He's not going to change his character whether we believe it or not. And you know, when you think about that, that's very humbling. Because bottom line, who are we? Our opinions, our thoughts, our ramblings, they're not going to change the character of God. He is still God, and he's going to continue to be God. He cannot deny himself. So I think this is what Paul would be saying. Timothy, you can walk away from your faith, but it's not going to change the power of the gospel. It's not going to change the truth of the gospel. His word is still going to go forward because he's still God. He cannot deny himself. Wow. Paul is using some pretty forceful truths to come at Timothy in this passage. But he's doing it because he cares. He wanted Timothy to get this in his spirit. And you know, when we get it in our spirit, there's just something that kind of begins to happen that is not about us. It's about him. And so I want to encourage you this morning. You stay focused on Jesus Christ who rose from the dead. No matter what you're facing, his word is truth, and it's going to prevail. It is not chained by your circumstances. He is still God, and he's always going to be God. Amen? Let's pray. Father, I thank you this morning for your word, and I thank you for these promises that you have shared with us today. And Lord, I lift up every woman who's here with us today, those who will be watching later on, no matter what they're facing, dealing with, God, doubts, fears, unbelief, just whatever they're struggling with, remind them by the power of the Holy Spirit, you are still God. Whether they feel you or not, whether they seem to be able to apprehend everything you're showing them, you are still God, and your truth, your righteousness, your power, your grace and mercy, it still prevails. Oh, I pray, Holy Spirit, open our minds and our hearts to that today. Strengthen us by your power to receive it and to walk in confidence in that today. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your promises, and we thank you for your unchanging nature, your character that is not shaken, that is not rattled, that is not moved by all the stuff around us. You're settled, you're strong, you're secure, and we can trust in you, Lord. Truly, you are our refuge. Truly, O Lord, you are our fortress. Truly, Lord, You, O God, love us with a steadfast love. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for these promises today. Lord, we give you praise that you have been with us in this session. Thank you, Father, for your word that we have privilege to break it apart. Oh, continue to strengthen us and stir in each one of us a love for your word and to receive it as your words directly to our hearts. We thank you and praise you for your many blessings. Amen. Amen. The Lord bless you, and we will see you next year. February the 7th, we'll resume, and we're just going to pick up right there, 2 Timothy. God bless you. Wait for the-